Will Iron be able to know us for our position to get this wonderful opportunity to welcome each and every one of you gathered here? I see so many senior members, elders and amis. We take this opportunity to welcome all of you. Well, this afternoon we are extremely privileged to have Dr. Peter D. Senan, who is from University of London. He'll be speaking on the topic, ethnomusicology as a means of understanding people in the past. Well, I won't speak much about him because we will have Dr. Divya, who will be giving more detail about him. Rather, let me request Dr. Divya, who is a consultant in IGNU, the National Open University, to introduce Dr. Peter.
Thank you. Thank you for having me on the panel. We have an eminent resource person, Dr. Professor Peter D. Senan from the University of London in the capacity of a senior research fellow. And he's also a learning and teaching expert in the University of Hertfordshire. He's also a member of the British Society for 18th Century Studies. That is how we have him here. And he is also a member at the Royal Historical Society, London. So basically, his expertise lies in the area of teaching and learning, developing curriculum, and he will be providing us with a new kind of approach today. And in this context, I would also just mention a few lines about thanks of support from ICSSR, because of which this was possible today. So I hand it over to Professor Peter
Senan. Thank you,
Dr. Divya, for giving a little introduction about Dr. Peter. Well, as Divya has said, because of the project that she is undertaking with ICSSR, that's how he could come here, and he has been delivering lectures in few universities. IGNU as well as Jamia, and today he is here. Thank you once again for accepting our invitation to come and give a presentation on this topic, ethnomusicology as a means of understanding people in the past. Well, today's session will be chaired by none other than Dr. Susmita Dasgupta, who actually needs no introduction. She has been a part of NSA. She has been chairing, she has chaired so many of our programs, and in fact, she is like an advisor to NSA. I have been taking a lot of help from her, guidance from her. And well, for those of you who do not know her, she is a chief economist in the Joint Plan Commission, Ministry of Steel. And also, she is a sociologist, economist, and also a writer. She has written so many books, and she has been a visiting faculty in so many reputed universities, including JNU, and of course. So we are really thankful to Dr. Susmita Dasgupta for accepting our invitation to chair today's session. Well, as a token of our love and appreciation, we have a small gift to our resource person today, and I would like to request my colleagues, Dr. Adon, to kindly hand over a small gift to our speaker for today, Dr. Peter D. Senan. Yeah.
Very kind.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
You
know a little about us.
Beautiful.
This is a mega show. I'll explain more about this show after the talk.
Wow. Oh, wow.
Yeah, let's all.
Thank you. Thank you. Get that picture. I must get, because I've got to get these pictures from my university at home, because they won't believe I'm away otherwise. Thank you so much. That's very generous.
Yes, sure.
Very.
And we also have.
Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Thank
for
you.
Accepting
that. Nice to meet you. Yes, thank you. Yeah. Look after that in the meanwhile. Thank you. Thank you so much.
We also have a small gift to Dr. Susmita Dasgupta. I request her colleague, Dr. Anton Tsukaini, our manager.
Thank you so much.
Because you have that. Next month, that is March, we have already engaged Mr. Abhishek Singh, I think, who is familiar with all the Nagas. He was an IS cadre from Nagaland and now posted here as a CEO of mygov.in. He will be giving a presentation, in NSA next month. He was supposed to come in November, but because of the problem here in Jin, we had to cancel that. So I'd like to request all of you to kindly keep that in mind and to come and join us. Yeah. So with this, I would like to give the rest of the time to our chairperson, Dr. Susmita Daskata.
Thank you, Zujama, so much, and thank you, Naga Scholars Association, for having me here so often, and I get lovely gifts as well. A warm welcome to Dr. Professor Peter D. Sena. When Jamu invited me for this talk, I said, yes, I will have to come because this is all about music. And then he said, you're the chair. That point I was a little distressed because I had not studied ethnomusicology. So I bought a book on Kindle, short introduction, and read it through the night, and here I am, feeling a little victorious. But to tell a very short thing before we begin Dr. Sena's talk is that you see the foundation of Indian sociology by Professor D.P. Mukherjee started with a 45-page slim volume which was called Introduction to Indian Music. So the heart of the Indian sociology, its disciplines, its methodology, its concepts and categories is the concept of the Indian music. So I think that we already have a foundation to an entire discipline basically founded upon the Indian music. So with this I would really, I'm looking forward to your presentation, Professor D. Sena, all yours.
Thank you very much indeed. Now I know I've got to speak into this, but I do tend to walk around.
Yes.
I don't know if that would work. And if I stand up, can you still hear me?
Yeah.
Sure.
I think you may be better here.
And then the other thing is, thank you so much. And then the other thing is that it's important you don't look at me. It's important you look at this, so we may need to turn the lights down. But if you want to move closer, please come closer now, or move, so that you can see.
Would there be any problem with the camera?
Well, that's better. Will that be fine? Will I be in the way of the screen?
It's fine.
Am I okay?
Yeah.
What I thought I'd do first of all is tell you a little bit about myself and what I'm interested in. I have been a teacher for over 40 years now. It's my passion. It's not just my job. I feel very lucky. But I also do historical research. I'll talk a little bit about how I started. But I've always been interested in looking at the past and looking at it in quite different ways. My students used to joke that if they asked me what the weather was like in the middle of the 14th century in the middle of England, that I'd be able to tell them. Because I said to them, this is important because most people lived in an agricultural setting and the weather was critical to their existence. Why shouldn't I, as a historian, know about the weather? And I was enormously interested in a whole set of things that did not include necessarily the kings, the queens, the politicians. Where I started, and I'm talking about when I was 20 years old now, and I was doing my first degree, is I had a tutor called John Rule. And John, I was doing his special subject on 18th century Britain. And John was very, very pleased with himself. He was just still a young lecturer, he was only in his 30s. And he walked in, he said, I've got a chapter in this book. And he told us all about it. And we were obviously very impressed because we were only 20 years old. But he told me about the book. And the book, Crime and Society in 18th Century England, was a book which looked at the lives of ordinary people. And of course, from the Southeast Asian tradition, you have a strong tradition of subaltern histories, looking at the lives of ordinary people. And this was really starting to gather pace. But my tutor's tutor was a very, in British and European terms, a very, very famous historian, Edward Thompson, on the left. And if you ever want to look at British history and look at the working classes, then you will find in every book there will be a reference to E.P. Thompson. Well, Edward Thompson decided to record a tape for us as a small group of students, John's students. And he was talking about the ways of finding the voices of the ordinary people of the 18th century. The people who could not read or write for themselves, who left no written record. And how would we do that? And he suggested that one of the very many ways was to look at the criminal records. Because people went into court, obviously they were very frightened because they thought they might be convicted and transported to Australia or to the West Indies. But this was at least some record, even though it wasn't the exact voice of the person in front of court. Because if I asked you, if you were in front of a court, what would you wear? You might put on some nice clothing, you might talk in a very measured way, you know, you'd act in a codified way, wouldn't you? But at least it was better than nothing. And so this is where I started off when I was just 20 years old. I was looking at the lives of ordinary people. And for my undergraduate dissertation, I looked at the London riots of the 1760s. But from there, I went on to do research on crime in 18th century London. And this was my postgraduate research. And I started to look at the Old Bailey, which is the central criminal court in London. And I was reading through, and I was looking for the crimes that I was interested in, which was really quite small, petty pilfering. It was just stealing little things at work, like stealing pens or paper or stealing small things in order to supplement the wage. And what I found was, to me, really quite interesting, because there were a whole number of references to people that I hadn't expected to be in the court. In the 1720s, 30s, 40s and 50s, there were black people, there were Indian people. In fact, there were hundreds of people who came from outside Europe who ended up in the London courts 250, almost 300 years ago. And this fascinated me. And I was looking at their voices. I was seeing the way in which they were being recorded, what their dialects were. And I was fascinated by this. And I started to find out more about London as a multicultural city. So after I finished my research, which was on crime, I started looking at the non-European presence in London and what their voice was, what they did, and where they lived. And you can see, just hidden in a number of pictures, although prominently at the front of this, there's a black woman in a London pub in the East End depicted. And so if you start to look at the literature, at the pictures, at the sources, you start to find this underclass or subgroup in London. And I thought, when I start teaching, I want my own students to explore this further, to find these invisible people, these people who had not been prominent in the sources. So this is where I come from. I come from what is called in England the history from below community. I don't know if that's a phrase that's ever used here, history from below, but that's what we called it in the 1970s. And then later on, I met a number of historians. I started going to the 18th century seminar and met a number of historians who were doing some, to me, very interesting work. The others were doing interesting work, but it was about kings and queens and politicians. This interested me far more. And Margaret Spufford, for instance, found that there were, in the fairs that went around the country, people were selling these very small chapbooks They were sometimes 8 pages, 16 pages. They were very cheaply printed. They could be bought for 1 penny. And this was literature for people who were barely literate, so it was simple. And very often, I don't know if you can see just there, you can see that sometimes they were song books. They were songs about executions or witchcraft or a whole number of other popular subjects. And these would travel the country. And it was a way of spreading news. And here you see that there is some about gender, identity, sexuality. Of course, these are the things that people will pay money for. They were interested in songs that told, I suppose, quite a sexy story. Yes? And then there was another historian that I met, this was years ago, over 30 years ago, called Roy Palmer. Roy wrote a number of books, but he wrote one book that really intrigued me. It was called The Rambling Soldier. And what he had found was hundreds of songs that were sung by soldiers when they were marching, when they were going into battle, when they were training. And what this did was to create a collective identity, a sense of morale. And I don't know if you've ever seen American films where GIs are marching and they're singing. Have you ever seen those sorts of films? Well, it does actually continue to this day. And I was told when coming here that Indian regiments also have their own songs. Well, they did certainly in Britain in the 17th and 18th centuries. In other words, this was something which tells you something about the mind, the values, the way in which institutions wanted their employees or their soldiers to behave. And in teaching, I was quite keen to develop this sense of research and engagement in my students. Now, I don't know if any of you want to be academics and university lecturers and teachers. Anybody here? Some of you already are. Yes? A lot of university teachers here? Most of them are teachers. Have a look at this. This was some research done on what's called research-informed teaching. The easy option is this, is that your students can be an audience. Like, you're an audience at the moment, aren't you? You're sitting there listening to me. But what I'm hoping to do is to move you from being an audience to being a participant in your own learning and your research. Can you see what Healy and Jenkins' research was coming up with over 10 years ago? It looked at a lot of information that had been written on educational research and pedagogy, and thought, this is the different types of research-informed teaching that happen in universities. So, this is lecturing very often, and you teach people about research in the discipline, research-led. But you can give your students the opportunity to develop their inquiry skills, but ideally, you want them to have their own research discussions. And I was intrigued when Divya told me that there are spaces in this university where students go in the evenings, at night time, and go and have these sorts of research discussions. So it seems as though JNU encourages this in its social spaces, yes? But that's not the case in every university. It's not. And it may well be that, people teach in university where that doesn't happen. But what I was keen to do was to take my students from here, because what they would do is this. They would say to me, tell me the answer. Tell me the answer. That's the soft way of learning, isn't it? That's the cheats way of learning. But what I wanted them to do more and more is to undertake their own research and inquiry so that they became research-based. This to me was important. So this pedagogic theory, I think, is a useful thing for us to stop and consider. And the other thing I wanted to do with my students was to get them to learn things that were troublesome, that were difficult, to do things that I did automatically with historical sources, with grappling with historiography, to go through what's called troublesome knowledge, to go from one state of knowing to another. And to do that, you need to pass through a liminal state. Now, this has been written about by educational theorists like Meyer and Land, and they call this the threshold concepts, going from one threshold to another. Well, how was I going to do this? I was going to do this by using a number of pedagogic or educational devices that I found useful to me. Now, I'm going to show you one that's useful to me, because this was devised by historians in Indiana State University. So this comes from people like us, if you like. The historians were finding that their students were finding certain things difficult. They were finding it difficult to go from this level up to this level. They were hitting what the Americans, all these lovely phrases, the Americans called them bottlenecks. They said, here's a bottleneck in their learning. And their job, they thought, was to think, what is it that I do as an expert? What is my tacit knowledge that I need to actually spell out, to make explicit? Because, can I tell you what your trouble is? I'm going to tell you, I've come 4,500 miles, and I'm being awfully rude to you, but I'm going to tell you what your trouble is. Your trouble is you know too much. And your students are not yet at that state of being. And you do things automatically with your historical material or with your other intellectual material that they still need to learn to manipulate. And so, you've got to think, what are the operations that you do with your source material, with your historiography, your primary sources, with your debates in history? What is it you do, and how are you going to show your students what you do? Well, I've found, and this is why I'm turning to ethnomusicology, I found ethnomusicology a good way of showing students how to use primary sources. I've found that they've to them, it seems more accessible. They get it. And I give them a chance to practice on musical sources in order to understand the 18th century far better. And I motivate them by, well, all sorts of devices, by getting them involved in the classes, by making them feel as though they are able to research and contribute. And then I set them tasks at the end, which are authentic assessment. They are not the kind of thing that you would necessarily do. Well, you can't necessarily achieve it in a 3,000 word essay. So, hands up if you're a radical university. So you're not, because you're not putting your hands up. So you're a bit conservative to me. Are you radical enough to sing? Because do you want to know what the sound of the 18th century is like? Because if you do, then you might want to start to make those sounds yourself by the end of this lecture. So can I ask the question again? Are you a radical university?
We all come on different universities, actually.
Come on, I've come 4,500 miles. Say yes. Say yes, we are. We are radical enough to sing an 18th century song. Is that a yes? Great, you're coming up the front with me right now.
Okay.
Good. I want to show you something that I discovered when I was 17 years old. I discovered that there was a band called Steel Ice Band. And they had electrical instruments, but what they did was they did historical research on 18th century music. And they took 18th century tunes, lyrics, and they called their LP, their long player album, Parson of Rogues in a Nation. That is a poem by Robert Burns, the famous Scottish poet. And it's about the Scottish lords in 1695
who sold out to the English in what was called the Darien scheme. It was a commercial scheme. And because they made so much money, they were prepared to vote away Scottish independence in 1707. And ever since 1707, Scotland has been joined to England in the Act of Union. And of course now it led to the beginnings of Great Britain. So it was actually one of the biggest changes in British history. But Robert Burns said that the people, the earls in Scotland who did this, were a parcel of rogues in a nation. They sold Scotland. And I was intrigued by this because it was put to music. It became really very popular in the 1790s. And what they did was to recreate that using electrical instruments. Now, before we go on, I'm going to ask you a question, because this is Friday afternoon, so you must participate. Yes? Can you tell me, can you think of an example in the British royal family where a prince or a king, the public think the prince or a king has been exploited by a manipulative wife or mistress, that she's come from another country, that she's spoilt their poor innocent man. Not only that, but she's had a child with him, so that now he's completely, you know, besotted with her. She even wants him to go away from the country and stay away from the country. And of course, he is now sex dependent on her, emotionally dependent on her. Can you think of any examples of this in the British royal family? Edward the VIII, Anne Boleyn. Thank you, that's two. Anyone else?
Another one.
Prince Harry and... Well, I would never have thought of that.
I've never thought of that one.
Anyway. Correct?
Oh, yeah.
Sorry, I'll stop for my cup of tea while you digest that.
Can you see what you can do with the class? This is a Swiss educationist called Piaget. So here's the educational theory behind what I've just done. A Swiss educationist called Piaget suggested that students, normally from about the age of 12, 13, 14, can start to turn the concrete, definite, you know, from their own experience, into the abstract. Okay? Now, what I'm suggesting you can do with novices, new learners, the 18, 19 year olds who come here, is to use examples from their own experience. I know this is slightly, you know, a constructivist view, but there is some merit in it. The idea that you can ask them to work from their own knowledge and experience. So you went for that one first, so I guessed right. And eventually we got to that one. You were just too shy to say it, but it's obvious, isn't it? And that's what you do with a class. Because these are demonized women in society. And we kind of know their stories, don't we? But this is the one I'm interested in because I'm teaching 18th century gender and sexuality. I'm teaching about George I. And the mistress, he came to England in 1714 after the death of Queen Anne. He came along with two mistresses. Why have one when you can have two, obviously. And this one, Melusine von der Schulenburg, was known as the Maypole because she was that tall and that wide. So very tall, very skinny. And the other one was that tall and that wide. So one was called the Maypole and one was called the Elephant. And you can see that this is the classic way in which xenophobic depictions of foreign women and women in general in the press continue to this day. But he was also a a Protestant king. And in Scotland, there was still the idea that their former heir to the throne, James, who was a Catholic, should be king. And so we're going to need, Vivian, we're going to need number six, I think. So here, I'll tell you when to start.
You're going to take it to the next door, Vivian. Nearest one.
Yeah. Here we have a song that was created in 1714, 1715 in Scotland. And I've used this with students because one of the things that I've found with students is that they find it difficult to do the things that I do very easily. I can now read an 18th century source very quickly. Yeah? Easy. But an 18, 19 year old is finding that difficult. Because it's written in Scottish dialect, but it has a very rich context. This is called Come Ye From France, meaning, have you come over from France? Well, of course, George I did come over from France. He came over with his mistress. Come ye o from France, come ye do by London. London. Saw ye Geordie Whelps. Geordie is the diminutive, the familiar name for George, Geordie. Whelps is a pack of hounds or dogs. So immediately the Scottish song, which is a mocking song, is giving a clear indication of what the Scots think of this new Protestant king. Have you come over from France? Come you down by London? Saw you pack of Georgian dogs and his bonny woman? I think you know what that means, yeah? Bonny woman. Were ye at the place called the Kittlehousie? What's a Kittlehousie? A what?
D-house?
It's a brothel. Because that's the morals of this new king, according to this mocking song. Were ye at the place called the brothel? Saw ye Geordie Grace riding on a goosey. Goosey, conventional slang in England for a prostitute. So, you come along here riding on your prostitute. It's a good first verse, isn't it? And it's written in Scottish dialect so that the English soldiers and the English people can't understand it readily. But everyone in Scotland knows it, and they're laughing, they're mocking the new king. So, can you play it, Vivian? Please look at this while she's playing it, because you're going to follow it and see how I use this with students. To draw them in and to motivate them. Remember that decoding wheel, one of the key elements in it is to motivate students to learn. So, what we have here in the second verse is that, and this is really nasty stuff if you start to decode the meaning of it. Have a look at this. He's a man, there's little doubt of it. Well, we're going to question whether he is a man. Because there came a blade
That is Count Philip Christoph von Königsmark, who had an affair with George's wife. And what they're saying is that he had sex rather like George did with his wife, and it's insinuating that because he had sex at the loom, meaning the wife's sexual organs of the king, that in fact the heir to the throne is not George the First's son, but the heir is illegitimate. So when you show this to students, they become quite engaged, because what is quite an impenetrable source, you can then play back, and they start to engage more readily with it. Now, I'm not saying this was the whole of the course. I used to teach 12 weeks, and this was one of the weeks, one out of 12. But I introduced this, and I found that students, when they were choosing their assignment, half of them wanted to do the assignment which was about the history of music, because they found that they were able to understand the 18th century more easily and more imaginatively and be more motivated to do the research. So I would give them one song, okay, give them a choice of songs. They would choose one and I'd say, right, you have got to do the research. Remember the quadrant, the diagram I was showing you about how to get them to be research based. They would have to go and research the other song and do a comparative analysis of what it told them about prostitution, gender, the monarchy, mistresses, whatever. Yeah, so, in other words, I was thinking with backward design what the appropriate outcome would be. Can you see how I'm trying to get this jigsaw to work? And this is what I'm suggesting to you. I'm not suggesting you change your teaching. What I'm suggesting is that you think carefully about ways to enhance your teaching through this more imaginative use, maybe of music, to engage people who might not want to come to your lectures to come. They'll be more keen to come if they think something's going to, they think something random is going to happen that they don't get in our lectures. My centre of expertise is actually on crime. And so I used to show them execution ballads. And the one that really fascinated me, even when I was, 16, 17, was one that I came across called, this is before I went to university, one called Gallus Pole. It was called Gallows Pole, and it was produced then in the 20th century by a band called Led Zeppelin. But I'll talk more about them later. It was based on a 15th century song about people being able to go to the gallows and rescue someone from being hanged if they paid a certain amount of money. A fascinating piece of historical material that is enshrined in song. But I'm going to talk more about Gallows Pole later on. I'm leaving this as a running trope for you, the gallows. A bit of a morbid one for a Friday afternoon, but there it is. Now, anyone feeling quite radical? You were, weren't you? Would anyone else like to sing? How would anyone like to make the sound of the 18th century? Because if you don't, then I'm going to go away saying that you're not radical at all. But it's just a sham. Right, come on in. Good. This is your moment of fame, you're on film.
Come and sit down.
Yes.
Yeah, your name is?
Lausanne.
Pleased to meet you.
Thank you.
Pleased to meet you. Thank you.
He's the PhD scholar here.
PhD scholar, you're going to go far.
I can use the mic.
You're going to go, you won't need a mic. Mics are for people who don't see.
Look at this song. This song was originally from 1796. And it's called The Black Velvet Band. It's a song about prostitution, thief-taking, where somebody is given stolen goods and then given in to the police for a reward, going in front of court, being sentenced to be transported for 7 years to Tasmania, which then was called Van Diemen's Land. And it's also about temperance and the evils of drink.
But it's also about seduction and gender. That's quite a lot in one song, isn't it? It's a lot for students, but they can use it in conjunction with other historical sources that they're probably more familiar with in print culture. And disaggregate it and look at the way in which it's written to see all of those themes. And then, of course, what I ask them to do is to find the provenance of it. Now, 1796, the first thing they will find, I will tell you, the first thing they find, and you will find, if you look this up, is you'll find that it's written in 1950, and you'll think it only goes back that far. And it's an Irish song. No, it was first published in 1796 in Manchester, in England. And where it says Belfast there, it had Manchester. And when they sang it in London, it had London. In other words, this is just a transportable song in the 18th century. And so they're finding different versions. Right, I'm going to sing the first verse and then you're going to copy me. Right, stand up. Right. Well, have a look at me. Her eyes, they shone like the diamonds. You'd think she was queen of the land. And her hair hung over her shoulders, tied up with a black velvet band. You happy with that? You're going to sing that.
Maybe one line at a time?
Yeah, of course. Her eyes, they shone like the diamonds. You'd think she was queen of the land. And her hair hung over her shoulders, tied up with a black velvet band. Black velvet band? Of course, that's what a prostitute would wear to seduce you. Velvet has the feeling, that sumptuous feeling. Her hair is luxuriant. The beauty coming out with... Can you see all these signifiers, if you like, in the song? And it was a warning because very often, and I'm going to go through it. So he's an apprentice in Belfast. He works hard. He's walking down the street minding his own business, and she comes along. They're strolling along, and she's stolen a watch from someone and puts it into his hand. And then the law catches him with the watch in his hand. And watches are, well, they are for the rich in the 18th century. The timepiece was such an important thing. Edward Thompson wrote about this, Time, Work and Labour Discipline. A watch or a timepiece is given to you when you retire, because that's when you have your own time. Watches would take 20 weeks of wages. Right, we're going to just show you the next verse. He appears before judge and jury, and the judge, he says, young fellow, the case against you is quite clear. 7 long years is your sentence, you're going to Van Diemen's Land. So this is an 18th century depiction of Van Diemen's Land, which also had the genocide of Aboriginal people. Can you see the opportunities that you've got for your students to research a whole number of issues? So from this, they've started to look at the perspectives of Aboriginal peoples from their own perspective, not from the colonial perspective. In the last verse, I did say there was a warning about liquor. And avoiding the pretty Colleens, the pretty young women. This song is sung every weekend in Irish pubs in Ireland. It's one of the most popular, if you ever go to Ireland, you'll hear this in almost every pub, every weekend, now. And they think the song is only 50 or 60 years old. It's interesting. So I'm going to sing one verse, and then you're going to sing the chorus. Are you happy with that?
Yeah.
Right. You happy?
Yeah.
Okay, I'll sing this verse, and then you're going to sing that one. And then we're going to discuss this as an educational strategy, because this is the point. You're going to help him.
I wish I could help.
You're going to help him. Next morning before judge and jury, a trial I had to appear. And the judge, he says, young fellow, the case against you is quite clear. For 7 long years is your sentence, you're going to Van Diemen's Land. Far away from your friends and relations to follow the black velvet band. Come on, everyone. Her eyes, they shone like the diamonds.
You'd think she was queen of the land. And her hair hung over her shoulders, tied up with a black velvet band.
Oh, you're good.
So, oh, I'm going to kick that. So come on, all you young fellows, a warning be had by me. Whenever you're out in the liquor, me lass, beware of the pretty Colleens. For they'll fill you with whiskey and porter, till you are not able to stand. And the very next thing that you know, me lass, you've landed in Van Diemen's Land.
Chorus.
Her eyes, they shone like the diamonds. You think you were queen of the land. And her hair hung over her shoulders, tied up with the black of the band.
We need the chorus leader, and you were the chorus leader. Well done. Well done. Now, tell me about this. Think back to the educational strategy. And about motivating students, please. Are they going to go out of your lecture remembering it? The answer is probably more likely than me standing here for 50 minutes droning on about crime and gender. Not that there's anything wrong with that, but if you do this sort of educational practice once in a while, it's a big hook. And it also makes people attend because they think, what's he going to do next? Yeah? And it makes them, I think, more interested in coming up with the melodies for songs, because I always say to people, I will give you an extra mark if you can find the melody. And I'll buy you a drink if you can sing it. Yes? Okay, so what I want to finish on one point though, which is really rather important. And that's a historical inquiry point for me. Travels with people. So now, in parts of London, Indian music is really very popular because we have large parts of London where there are Indian populations. Now, in the 18th century, we have large migration due to transportation of criminals, diasporas, and particularly in this part of North America, the Appalachians, from Pennsylvania down to Alabama. There were a large number of convicts in the 18th century who took Irish and Scottish music. So you'll find that there is also the migration of music, language and tradition. And the map works today. I showed this to people the other day, and what happened was the lines were there.
Yeah.
So here we have a map which actually shows the migration of music in the 18th century. This is the transportation of criminals in the 18th century. And you can see how Scottish and Irish music ended up in the Appalachians. Because with diasporas goes the written word, but also the sung word. And remember, there are a whole number of people who are in the criminal classes who couldn't necessarily read and write readily, but they could take their songs with them and their traditions. Now, there are problems with that. Sorry, I tried it there. There are problems with that, and somebody the other day pointed this out. It's really quite important because this is a commodified past, really. It's what survives. And making this clear to students is important because historiography isn't necessarily what happened. It's the debate about what might have happened or did happen in somebody's perspective. And when there was the introduction of recording instruments, the gramophone, in the 1920s, anthropologists, who were fairly new as a discipline, only 40 years old or so, thought that they could collect the authentic voice of the indigenous other. And here you see rather famously Frances Densmore collecting the voice of a Native American chief because she wanted to record the language, the meter, the pattern, the traditions of Native Americans that went back into the 18th century. And here, and the one that was particularly of interest to me, was Lomax, Alan Lomax, who went into the deep south of America, more or less here, Mississippi, Louisiana, to record the voices of the sons and daughters and the grandsons and granddaughters of slaves who were developing a new style of music called the blues. And he was really interested in this as a form of expression. But what someone like Cecil Sharp was finding in his recordings of old world music, meaning the music of people who had originally come from Europe, the old world, was that you would find Irish and Scottish music and English music in this area of Virginia, North Carolina, and so on. This is where he was finding it. And the bands at that time, in the 20s and 30s, looked like Irish bands. Of course, they had morphed into their own particular style. But it was the origins of country music. I want to go back to Gallows, Poland, Led Zeppelin. Up came, as you do when you're 15, 16, 17, a little bit sooner, trying to get into psychedelic music and that kind of thing. You want to be a bit on the edge. I was listening to this in 1971, and I was intrigued to find that there was a song in it called When the Levee Breaks, and it was about the flood of 1927. And interestingly, someone called Beyoncé, you heard of her? Beyoncé was also influenced by Memphis Minnie, who'd written in about the floods of 1927, but she converted it to be about the Hurricane Katrina and the way that people, black people mostly living in poor areas of New Orleans, had suffered disproportionately from it by the levees breaking. Now, historians have written quite seriously about this, and Mizell from the University in Arizona found that there were about over 200 songs written about the 1927 flood. And a way to draw students into ethnomusicology is to show them that it provides a distinct and interesting historical methodology that's still being worked out and that students can play a part in themselves. So he took the songs that were about the Mississippi flood of 1927 and looked for the voices of black people who left no other written record about it. Equally, and this is one that really fascinates me, a scholar called Adam Gussell, 2 years ago, found that at the same time, in the 1920s and 30s, black blues music, he found 290 songs, just a few more, that mentioned Satan and the devil. And it was providing for him an insight into ideas, values, and beliefs of black people in the 1920s and 30s. Some of which had roots in slavery. And so there are a number of quite convincing, interesting, contestable obviously, methodologies that are working themselves out now in the last few years by scholars researching ethnomusicology. We're not going to be able to play this because we don't have time, and B, we couldn't get the technology to play the music. But this is when the levee breaks from 1927. And it shows the extent of the flood of 1927 in song. Now, Katrina, you've heard of Hurricane Katrina, I suppose?
Yes.
Hurricane Katrina took out that much. There's New Orleans. This is the flood of 1927. How many of you heard about the flood of 1927? You heard of Katrina?
Yeah.
Yes.
Not this one?
Not this one.
This one's 10 times the size. And what this led to was one of the major changes in American history. About 600 people died, they were flooded out. Crops were ruined, livelihoods were lost. And black people who, particularly black people, but also poor white people, whose voices were ignored by history or who didn't leave any legacy, were not able to record their feelings, although Mizell has actually found it through song. I'm going to show you some pictures of when the levees broke. The levees are the high barriers here, which were supposed to contain the flood. It went all along here. Bessie Smith, the Queen of the Blues, wrote Blackwater Blues and sang it. That was recorded and played. That became very popular. Here's the flood. The refugees. It looks like a war zone, doesn't it? And one of the interesting things was that black people who tried to leave and go up north to safer territory like Chicago were being shot by the white plantation owners because they didn't want to lose their labour. Because not many people know about peonage, which is a successor to slavery, but it still held black people in place. So this is something that I use to engage with quite interesting critical debates about post-slavery in America, which students aren't necessarily familiar with. And song is one of the ways of doing that. Other songs. But here, what people were doing, some people, was they were going to Chicago. Am I allowed, have I got time to play two songs?
No, but yeah.
Can I? Can I do it? I'll do it online, Julian, because I'll do it online. Well, what I do, I'll go out to it and I'll come back in. You'll have to look carefully at this. Can you peek as far as you can into my computer when I turn it around? Hang on. I need to do that. It's about migration. Teaching of cultural studies in the 20th century with students, it didn't mean that I was stopping what I was doing before. It was just that I was using ethnomusicology to enhance the teaching, to improve the engagement. I normally found that students didn't want me to turn off the music, that they become so pulled into the source. And when they heard that the counting was taken from another singer who had taken it from his father, who had heard his grandfather in the cotton fields using the counting as part of the chants that they used while they were working to keep their momentum going, it actually gave an interesting provenance to the song, as well as the idea of going to California, when in fact they were going to Chicago, and they're not near to each other at all. But the idea of California as the imagined paradise in the 1930s depression was something that was obvious to them, that came through literature. But there was a big transit of black people to Chicago in the 1930s. Why stay in Mississippi and work for $1 a week when you go to these new things called car factories run by someone called Fords and earn $1 a day? And so there was migration. And so for history students who are not studying music, music was used as an eye-opener to look at the historical context in a much richer way. And what I do is talk about the way in which music became urbanized. Because what was interesting at that time was that the types of blues music that were popular in the plantations, and here I show you one of the most important of the plantations, the Hobson and the Dockery were the others, was the other, near a place called Clarksdale, is that when the blues music went up north, it became urbanized. And there were these new electrical instruments in the 1940s, which changed the whole way in which blues music was made. And actually, blues music then became unpopular with black people in this new urban setting because it was associated with slavery and deprivation and the poor South. They invented new genres, Motown music, soul music. Although in teaching civil rights and looking at the roots of civil rights, I still use the obvious sources with all the, you know, the likely suspects like Martin Luther King. Who doesn't? But we look at the black perspective, not just through black pamphlets and literature, but also through music, because this is a way in which crowds were motivated. And we talked the other day about, in another group, about football chanting and chanting in crowds to arouse passions. Because music did that in the civil rights movement, particularly Billie Holiday with the song called Strange Fruits. The Strange Fruit were black people being lynched and hung from trees. Or Big Bill Brunsey's Black, Brown and White, which is about the privilege, white privilege, relative privilege of brown people. But if you're black, oh brother, get back, get back, get back, which is a big song in 1939. Then we go on to talk about the use of song by the civil rights movement in the 1960s. Sam Cooke, Change Is Gonna Come. Some of you may have heard that one. But I talk about others in relation to black power. But I'm just going to wrap up now by giving you a couple of quite interesting tweaks on 20th century blues music. Because the idea of the radio and television and cross-cultural currents are something that start to emerge after World War II. When my students are studying class and gender and race. And I show them how a young 18-year-old white man becomes famous for singing black music, which he takes his first hit from Arthur Crudup. He takes That's All Right and turns it into his hit, first hit in 1954. And equally interesting is that this is a two-way developmental cycle, that the most famous of the black performers, Chuck Berry, is starting to sing white rock hillbilly music. In other words, it shows something about the subcultures in America, about mixing. I'm going to return now to Gallows Pole. Do you remember that? Gallows Pole, the execution band. Alan Lomax went into the prisons, the hardest prisons in Mississippi, because he was determined to find the person they said was the greatest blues singer of the 1930s. Hoodie Leadbetter, also known as Leadbelly. And he sang a number of songs. He sang something called Gallows Pole, which he thought was an 18th century song. And he made it famous, it became a recording. Of course it was Gallows Pole from the 15th century. But somehow it had gone from England, southern England, into the Appalachians and down into the prisons in Mississippi. And then back to Led Zeppelin in 1971. An interesting migration of music and ideology. And when you talk about this sort of migration of music, it makes students better understand the migration of other ideas and beliefs. And someone at Oxford called Dr. Peter Francois, at one of the Oxford colleges, is using big data to look at the migration of ideas, religious ideas, across Europe and across the world. So this is part of a bigger project. It's not just a little fantasy that's associated with this type of music. It's been used elsewhere. But Hoodie Leadbetter is a really interesting one because I'm a big football fan. Anyone here like football?
Everybody.
Yeah. Everyone likes football. Oh, I'm going to show you one of the really big clubs in the next slide now. You ready for this? Leadbelly recorded something which wasn't blues. It was when he was in prison. It was more or less a 3-4 waltz. It was a bit of a lament. He was missing Irene. He was guilty about murdering someone and being in prison. And he sang this song called Goodnight Irene. And I will tell you a personal story now, that my father came from Rajahmundry in the south of India. And his father, when my grandfather's mother died, my great-grandmother was called Irene. And he heard this and used to sing this song after his mother's death. And this was 22 years ago, my father sang this to me. He said, this is what your grandfather, who you never met, used to sing. And I was in tears, because music can do that to you. It's not just about understanding people in the past, it's about understanding people in the present, isn't it? Highly emotive. So I'm using this, but it was picked up by a group that was banned by the Americans in the 1950s because they were deemed to be a communist group in the McCarthyites era of persecution of left-wingers in the United States. And they sang Goodnight Irene in a folk festival. But here's how I came across it, apart from my father. Of course, it's a song that's sung every weekend in Irish pubs because they think they invented it in the 1950s. And in fact, it's on volume one of Irish songs. They're claiming that it's one of theirs, Goodnight Irene, when in fact it's a Mississippi prison song. I wish I had the internet to show you this. But it's sung at every home game of Bristol Rovers. Why? It's because it goes back into the 1950s when they were waving goodbye at the other side, who they had defeated. And they'd sung it every week since the 1950s. In other words, there is this transport of ideas that I bring across to students. I'm going to end now because I think I've talked for long enough. Blues music has come across into the mainstream in Britain in the 1960s and 70s. So that the Rolling Stones, who you will have heard of, actually their early songs, most of them, were taken from Willie Dixon. The Beatles took a lot from Ravi Shankar. And I was really pleased to learn that one of the people in Delhi who plays authentic 1950s blues instruments is playing Delhi Mississippi Blues. And I wish that he'd been in this weekend so that I could see him. So you have your own blues artist here, apparently. So I'm going to sum up very, very quickly. I'm going to play you something, if I may. You need to look very closely at this. Bearing in mind what you heard earlier, Here's someone very famous singing. Interest. I've looked at the pedagogic theory behind it. I'll tell you, this is what my mother used to say to me. She said, never trust anyone who doesn't like animals or music. I found that in my students, a hook, you know that Piaget's, the educational theorist, the idea of the hook of music is often a way of allowing students to better understand primary historical sources from a completely different era, from the early modern era, to motivate them to do their own research, to allow them accessibility to complex ideas in the past, and in summary, not just to better understand people in the past, but to think about relationships between people and music and continuity and change in music as they see it replicated through time. So I'll leave this with you as an idea that you might want to think about in your own teaching. Just experiment with it and see how the students take to it and whether they do or they don't. But I think it might well, give you some sort of traction with them and with some students who have been disengaged. It might well be engaged by this approach. Okay, that will do for the moment. And thank you to you.